happy creativity. Well, this is Runshell here with the 11th painting session with Carla in the Rose Garden. And now it's Golden Retriever dogs, Kira and Conan. Now I wet my palette by spraying it with water before I start a new painting session. I'm wetting a synthetic brush and rubbing it into a cake of soap because I intend to put more masking fluid. I'm using the Winsor & Newton Art Masking Fluid, and I'm masking out some of the areas where I want the light-coloured rose blooms. Now, I'm going over areas that are white and also areas that are very pale greens or pale blues, because some of these roses will be partially in shadow, so they won't be completely white. But what I'm wanting to do is to darken some of the background so that there'll be more focus put on Carla and the two dogs. And I needed to go back in and mask out. Now, you can mask over pure white paper, or you can mask over paper that's already been treated with a watercolor wash. It's best if you put this on fairly thick, because we're needing to rub it out once it's fully dry and you've done the painting over it. And it's going to be a lot easier to rub out if you put it on relatively thickly. It's important to get all of it rubbed off, because if you leave any there, it's going to yellow and stain the paper over a period of time. It's also very hard to get it off if you don't get it off, say, in a reasonable amount of time. I tend to like to complete anything that's had masking fluid on within the week after I put the masking fluid on. No good leaving. Now, the masking fluid can be quite damaging to your brush, and that's why I'm using a less expensive synthetic airbrush to apply the masking fluid. And it's also why I rub the brush into a cake of soap before I apply the masking fluid. That soap is going to help me remove the masking fluid out of the brush afterwards and not ruin the brush. I've seen some people actually dip the brush into liquid detergent. I haven't tried that technique, and there's always something to learn. Now I'm just going back in with the pure sable brush and emulsifying some of that indigo pastel pencil that I put into the shadows in the around the fingers, around the arms of Carla. I hadn't done that as yet. I put down the indigo pastel pencil when I marked out the dog shape, and I did it for the arms and the fingers, but I hadn't gone in and emulsified it on Carla. I had only worked it on the dogs. So that was one little touch that I needed to get back and fix. There still will be quite a bit that I'll need to do in this area. Now, last week, if you're in my Patreon, you may have noticed that I loaded videos for my patrons and then I unloaded them and then put them back several times. I was having a little bit of trouble with the YouTube system, trying to get them to host. I was having a little bit of hacking was taking place with my hosting of YouTube videos privately just for my patrons' view. So I've had to look around and find a better way to deliver those videos. And I've chosen the Vimeo program that will allow me to deliver up to 2 hours of tutorial content to you per week if the file's not too heavy. So we'll see how that plays out for now. And you can help me by recommending my tutorials, because I'll need to pay for that extra cost. I've already got quite a few expenses involved in delivering lessons for you, and I had hoped not to have to find more costs at this stage until perhaps I had a few more students. So if you're happy with your tutorials and you can recommend my tutorials to other people. A couple more students will help me cover the cost of hosting these videos so that you can get a smoother delivery via Vimeo. It also saves you having YouTube recommending videos you might not want to watch at the end or their advertisements. Now, for those of you interested in the business side of art, and I know quite a few of you are, I'll go into the routine that I'm starting to get myself into for delivering these tutorial videos. I'm going to give you what would be the equivalent of attending a 3-hour lesson with me each week. Now, that 3-hour lesson will be broken down into about 10-minute videos approximately each, because that's what most hosting programs recommend for tutorial videos. That's what Teachable and Thinkific and all of those places that host lessons say is the right attention span for a tutorial. So I'm following that recommendation. So I will be painting in a 20-minute time slot and then taking my break. And then I go away, and it's about half day's work then to deliver that back to you as 2 10-minute tutorial videos. Now, I'll be condensing the 3 hours a week down to about 2 hours of tightly developed tutorial videos, which will probably be coming to you at about 2 videos a day for about 5, 6 days a week, something like that. And that will give you the equivalent of a full 3-hour class with me. It would actually be easier for me if I had, say, 8 students here in a 3-hour class, because you wouldn't have all that editing. But because we're delivering this online, there's the advantage to you that you will be getting those lessons at a fraction of the price of coming to me for a small group class. And I'll have the extra work of basically a full-time editing schedule to put that out. Then I will be condensing that lesson into could be anything from 6 minutes, 12 minutes, whatever, into a time-lapse demonstration, which will go onto YouTube with music. And I'd love it if you'd support me there too. Perhaps give the video a like or a comment, and also let people know about it. That would be a huge help to me. So you will be getting the bulk of my demonstration tutorials, and I'll be working full time to create the work. Now, some paintings I can't do in 3 hours. This painting, for instance, I couldn't complete in 3 hours. So occasionally you'll get a painting that might stretch over a couple of weeks to complete. But I'll strive to do as many as I can at about a 3-hour length of time video painting lesson. As I said, condense it down to about 2 hours worth of tutorial, because you don't need to waste an hour just watching me perhaps dipping my brush into water. All of those little bits where you reach for a tissue to blot and things like that could be edited out, so you have a much tighter video without missing the actual brushstroke work. And that's behind the scenes work, but it's time saving for you. Hopefully will make the demonstrations more interesting, and it'll also save on the hosting fees and for the amount of time that I'd be paying for the private hosting of the video. I can give you more high quality tutorial content rather than just, paying for my dipping, as I said, the brush into water, which you don't need to have all of that included. I'm working back into these rose bushes and said I needed to darken that area behind, bring more focus onto Carla. I used cadmium orange for that glow behind. I'm using cobalt blue for my blues, and I'm using viridians. And that's the three colors that I'm working with entirely for this painting. I've worked very hard to kill back some of that yellow, which I put into the painting earlier in the piece and then regretted. That's the importance of planning your color harmony and sticking with it. The more I have worked into these roses, I really feel they've improved and they're far more natural now. You can tell that there's a flower garden behind, and because that flower garden is fairly high, some of those flowers are fairly large. It's not hard to sort of suggest without stating it absolutely clearly that these would be tall rose bushes or perhaps climbing roses that are behind Carla, without my having to explain it by putting any one of these into really crisp focus, which would take the attention away from the main subject, which is Carla and her dogs. I'm still thoroughly enjoying doing this work. 3, 2, 1. Now, I would like for you to ask any questions in the comments, because that gives me the opportunity to answer them in the following videos that I produce for this painting. If you don't ask the questions, I won't know what it is that you specifically need me to cover. I also have many different ways that I could finish this work off. I could finish this work off purely in watercolor. I could take pen and ink to it, and I could pen and ink into it. I could work in gouache. I could work in pastel, although I don't really feel it lends itself to that. I could go into coloring pencils, and I could go into pastel pencils. Now, you're my patrons. You're my students. If you have any preference, let me know, because I'll take your what it is that you're wanting to learn into consideration when I plan lessons. But that doesn't mean I'll necessarily be able to do what you specifically ask, but I can certainly take your interest into consideration. I have put the iris into my last work because I'd had a patron who specifically requested that I demonstrate an iris. So it took a little while for me to get to it because I needed to wait until I had an iris reference material. Sometimes I need to wait until something comes into flower in my garden. But I did get to it for her. So, as I said, ask. Let me know what it is that you're interested in. Now, what I'm doing here, I have a little mark on the paper, and I'm just going over that mark with some watercolor. I have rather think that my cat might have helped me paint a little bit of it, because I don't remember putting that mark that I was covering up on. I am really looking forward to when my cat deterrent mats arrive. I've ordered three plastic mats that have a little electrical circuit running through them and a battery attached, and you put a low voltage battery in, and it's just enough to give a little zap if your pets or cats wander over your art supplies. I'm at the point where my cats are getting a little bit too keen to help me with my paintings. So I'm looking forward to those arriving. They won't hurt the cats, but they will certainly keep them off my beautiful Sennelier pastels and any watercolor that I'm painting at the time. I need to be able to get up and leave my work and know the cats aren't going to add to it.